Okay, so a very good evening to all of you. This video is on our last odontogenic cyst, which is the odontogenic keratocyst. Now, this is a very difficult cyst to remember, and there are a lot of topics to study with it. So I'll make sure that you know all of these topics by the end of these videos. The time tags are in the description below. And for more such videos and more videos on the odontogenic tumors and cysts, you can check out the playlist on the channel to be told. Before we get into the OKC, a quick reminder, the cyst is defined as any pathological cavity which has some content. The content can be fluid, semi-fluid, or gaseous, and it is not pus. It can or cannot be lined by epithelium, and based on this, it is classified as your true or pseudocyst, epithelial or non-epithelial cyst, further classified as developmental or inflammatory cyst, and further classified as odontogenic and non-odontogenic cyst. We have already covered the developmental odontogenic cyst, which is the dentigerous cyst, and the inflammatory odontogenic cyst, which is the radicular cyst and residual cyst. In this video, we will talk about the primordial cyst, earlier called the primordial cyst, or now called the odontogenic keratocyst. Okay, so the first part tells us that this is a developmental odontogenic cyst. Right? So it is a developmental odontogenic cyst. It is benign but locally aggressive, and the terminology was given by Philipson in 1956. And the question is, why did Philipson call it the odontogenic keratocyst? This is because it produces a large amount of keratin. Now, this keratin can either be parakeratin or it can be orthokeratin. Okay, you'll study about this when I talk about the histopathology. Over the years, there have been multiple debates and controversies over whether it is a cyst or a tumor, right? So in 1956, Philipson called it a cyst, right? So he called it a cyst. Toller in 1967 called it a tumor. WHO in 1971 classified it as a cyst, and then in 2005 reclassified it as a tumor. In 2017 they again reclassified it as a cyst. So over the years it has been multiple times classified and then reclassified and then classified as your cyst or a tumor. Now the basic question is why? So the answer to this is because of its behavior. It is highly aggressive and destructive and recurrent. Okay, so this cyst is aggressive, locally aggressive, it invades surrounding tissues, and it is highly, highly recurrent, almost 33%. Okay, histopathologically, you see that the lining has innate growth potential, and in the genes, you see mutation in specific genes, right? For example, your PTCH gene. Apart from that, the reason why you need to study the OKC is because it has high malignant potential, as mentioned, high rate of recurrence, and an association with the nevoid basal cell carcinoma syndrome. So this syndrome we'll talk about in the end of this video. In the etiopathogenesis, it is associated, I already told you, this is for a developmental odontogenic cyst, right? So odontogenic means that it arises from cells that give rise to odontogenesis, right, that form the tooth. So here it is associated with the dental lamina or the cell rest of dental lamina, which are called the cell rest of Seres. Okay, the lining has a high innate potential for proliferation, and the cyst grows by resorption, the release of the resorption factors, which cause resorption of the surrounding bone, right? So innate growth potential of the lining and factors that cause resorption of the adjacent bone. Clinically, it can be seen at any age, but the peak is in the second and third decade, most commonly seen in males, and the most common site of occurrence is the mandible, right? So here you have the image on the right. It shows you that almost 70% of the times it is occurring in the mandible. In the mandible also, the most common site is the posterior mandible. In the posterior mandible, the most common site of occurrence is the ramus third molar area. So ramus extends from your angle up till superiorly towards the condyle and the coronoid, right? And here in the third molar region, right, at the end of the body. So it most commonly occurs in the ramus third molar area, like this. After that, it is most commonly seen in the second molar region, followed by the anterior, and even in the maxilla, the most common is the posterior maxilla. In its presentation, 50% of the times it is symptomatic. So 50% of the patients will come to you with some symptoms. What are the symptoms? It can be a swelling with or without pain. Now, this swelling can cause expansion of the bone, right? So most commonly, the lingual and the buccal bone. There may be associated paresthesia of the lip or teeth, displacement of the adjacent teeth, resorption of the adjacent teeth, and an association with the nevoid basal cell carcinoma syndrome. We'll discuss about this later. It can also be secondarily infected, right? So here, most frequently, the maxilla is secondarily infected. Radiographically, okay, so in the presentation, just to clear it out, we have studied that there can be a swelling with or without pain, with or without expansion, and sometimes paresthesia and displacement of adjacent teeth. Radiographically, what you see is that these are most commonly a unilocular, but sometimes a multilocular radiolucency with a well-defined peripheral rim. Now, this rim can be smooth or scalloped, and it is can be associated with an unerupted tooth. Okay, so let us see it in this image over here. Most commonly, it is a unilocular radiolucency, but in this diagram, you have a multilocular radiolucency with a certain septa that you see inside it. Apart from that, you see the border can be smooth or scalloped, right? So in this diagram, you have the typical scalloped border, right? And apart from that, the most important thing is the location. So the location, as you can see, it is the ramus third molar area, right? And it is associated with an unerupted tooth. It can cause a displacement or resorption of the roots of the adjacent teeth, and it may cause expansion of the cortical plates of the bone. Now, why this point is important is because if you look at other cysts, which is your dentigerous cyst or your radicular cyst, what you see is if this is the mandible, they tend to grow centripetally, which is they grow in all directions. So this causes your expansion of the buccal and lingual cortical plate. But the odontogenic keratocyst, it tends to grow in anterior-posterior direction. Right, so anteroposteriorly within the medullary cavity. Why I am stressing on this is because this allows it to grow to a large size without detection. Right, so it grows anteroposteriorly to a large size without detection, without expansion of the cortical plates initially. Further, the cyst of the maxillary sinus may the cyst of the maxilla can invade the maxillary sinus. Right? So with this, we have completed our radiographic features as well. There are four radiological subtypes, which are the replacement, envelopmental, extraneous, and collateral. The replacement forms in place of normal teeth, envelopmental embraces unerupted teeth, extraneous occurs away from the teeth, which is in the ascending ramus. And the collateral arises adjacent to the roots of the teeth, right? So here you have it in between the two roots, like a periodontal cyst. Its association, it is strongly associated with the nevoid basal cell carcinoma syndrome, which is also called the Gall-in-Gall syndrome, right? Now, the Gall-in-Gall syndrome is nothing but an autosomal dominant inherited condition caused by mutations in the PARCHT, PTCH tumor suppressor gene, right? Why it is important for you to study here is because with this syndrome, which is NVBCC or Gall-in-Galls, it is associated with your odontogenic keratocyst, right? Multiple odontogenic keratocysts. In this diagram, you have one in the ramus and one in the right maxilla. Apart from multiple odontogenic keratocysts, you also see some other things. which is multiple basal cell carcinomas, right? In the name itself, you have MBBCC. So multiple basal cell carcinomas, especially in the middle third of the face. You see multiple epidermal cysts of the skin. You see palmar and plantar pits, right? So this is the palm of a person's hand, and you see multiple pits on the palmar or plantar surfaces. You see calcification of the fox cerebri, right? Now, you know, the fox cerebri is your mid-sagittal. It is your mid-sagittal dural fold, right? It is a fold of the dura mater, mid-sagittally. So this tends to be calcified. It is also associated with enlarged head circumference, which is macrocephaly, and hypertiroidism, which is an increased space between the eyes. It is also associated with rib anomalies. So the ribs can be missing, fused, or bifid. And it is also associated with kyphoscoliosis and calcified ovarian fibromas. So if you get it as your 5-mark question, you should be able to name at least 5 things that you see here. So again, let us recall. First and foremost important, multiple odontogenic keratocysts, right? Next is multiple BCC. Third is palmar and plantar pits. Fourth is epidermal cysts of the skin. Fifth is your calcified fox cerebri. And then you can easily remember macrocephaly and hypertiroidism and rib anomalies. With this, let us just have some review questions. What is the most common site of occurrence? Mandibular ramus third molar area. Multiple OKC is associated with, it is your Collin-Gall syndrome or the nevoid basal cell carcinoma syndrome. The question can be twisted and they can actually ask you, basal cell nevus syndrome is associated with, so it is odontogenic keratocyst. The question can be, Collin-Gall syndrome is associated with which features? So here you already know that it is associated with bifid ribs. It is associated with multiple radiolucent lesions of the jaws or multiple OKCs. It is associated with multiple BCCs, and it is associated with fox cerebri calcification. So the answer is all of the above. Last question, odontogenic keratocyst has the following feature. Occurs due to infection periapically? No. That is the radicular cyst. It is developmental in origin? Yes. Arises from the cell rest of the array and can be treated by aspiration? No, it is highly recurrent. Right, so you need to remove the lining as well. With this, let us summarize whatever we have studied. Okay, so this the odontogenic keratocyst is a developmental odontogenic cyst which is locally aggressive. It is derived from the dental lamina or the remnants because of the cell of caries. Clinically seen at any age, male predilection, most commonly mandibular ramus third molar area. Presentation, 50% of it is symptomatic, where there is a swelling with or without pain, with or without expansion of bone. Paresthesia, displacement of adjacent teeth, may be secondarily infected and is associated with the nevoid basal cell carcinoma syndrome, which we have discussed in detail. The radiographic features, we saw it is unilocular or multilocular. Well-defined peripheral rim, which is smooth or shallow. It enlarges in the anteroposterior direction and may not show obvious cortical expansion and can grow to large size without detection. And the four types, which are replacement, envelopmental, extraneous, and collateral. In the next video, we'll study about the histopathology and treatment and causes of recurrence. So if you enjoyed this video and if this helped you, please do like, subscribe, and comment. And I'm glad that I could help you learn this topic. So thank you and have a good day.